afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Partnership for Supply Chain Management, I'd like to welcome you to this lunch event and panel discussion. Delighted to see a full room. I hope you've all managed to get some lunch before we start. My name is David Jamieson. I'm the Deputy Director for Global Partnerships at the Partnership for Supply Chain Management. My colleague, Gordon Comstock, who will introduce himself in a few moments, will actually manage the panel discussion. But I wanted to just take a couple of moments to set the problem statement as we see it in terms of how will the supply chain respond to the 90-90-90 targets. Those targets are, of course, quite complex. There are many facets to them, but one thing we do know, if we do not get the diagnostics and the drugs to the point of care for patients, then we will not reach anything on the on those targets. So our key question really is, can the supply chain meet 90-90-90? I'm assuming you all know 90-90-90, so I'm not going to go into that. But what we want to do today is to unpack some of the different challenges that face each of those 90s. And it is different for each of the 90s in our view. There are also, we will also explore some common themes that apply to each of each 90. And for that, we've got a nicely varied panel, I believe, representing manufacturers, WHO and UNAIDS, and the logistics chain. So I think it covers much of what we need to do. What we were not planning to do today is to get into a deep discussion about financing it. Obviously, funding is important, but it's too big a tail for us to tackle. We're going to stick to the technical challenges within the supply chain. For the first 90, it's very much established technology. The supplies are there, the capacity has always responded well, and we believe is still there. From a supply chain management point of view, there is a bit of concern about the dominance of one or two of the tests, and if there was a challenge in supply of Determine or one of the other major tests, that could cause quite significant disruption. But reaching the goal demands getting testing done in some very new and different places. Self-testing, what would that mean in terms of the distribution? So it's much of the challenge there is about a distribution and a supply chain. Treatment, of course, is the big one, essentially doubling the number of people on treatment, doubling the number of drugs, regular supply, how do we ensure that? And it's a moving target. If we don't get the new infections under control, and they're not coming under control, so the 90% target is growing by 2 million per day, or 90% per year. So what is needed to meet that? To date, the manufacturing base has been superb in expanding and meeting the challenges, and I believe they could continue to do so. But what is needed to enable them to do that? What more information, support, reassurance do they need from those of us in implementing these programs? Data, I think, is going to be essential, and I'm sure that will be discussed in the panel. The final 90, again, I understand, believe that the capacity is there. We have a lot of new technology. This is an area where there is technical innovation happening almost by the month. And that's going to demand a whole new network of us to get the viral, to conduct those viral load tests. And be interesting to hear what the panel think about that. Lastly, then, the two common themes that I'll mention, there are others, but data visibility, enabling accurate forecasting, a transparency of activity and pricing, and what are we doing? Highly successful supply chains are driven by data. We are still in the dark on some of our data. And private sector usage. There's a huge untapped potential in the private sector within the countries that we work, many of the countries in which we work. And we need to think about how we tap that potential, what innovation is needed. Do we dare to innovate and bring in the private sector? And in fact, if we don't dare to innovate in that way, we probably will not meet these targets. So that's enough from me in setting the problem statement. I hope I haven't given the answers. So that's more than enough from me. I'll hand over to Gordon, all yours.
Thank you, David. I'm Gordon Comstock, Director of the Global Supply Chain for the partnership, and I'll be moderating the panel discussion, and we'll encourage the audience later to ask some questions. Of course, David has said the big questions, or implied the big questions are, can we do this? Will the supply chain respond? What daring innovations do we need? It will be interesting to hear from each of you on your opinions and your perspectives, and I'm sure there may be differences, and we encourage discussing those differences. But I'd like to start with Dr. Peter Ghys. Peter is Director of Strategic Information and Evaluation at UNAIDS. He leads a department responsible for generating statistic information and analysis that increases better understanding of the state of the AIDS epidemic, the progress made at national, regional, and global levels, and cost-effective strategies for future responses. This department enables UNAIDS to strengthen its role as the global repository for data and analysis based on strategic information, technical assessment, and outcome analysis, drawn from the best available biomedical and social sciences, and bringing together different sources of data, methodologies, and stakeholders. Peter has been with UNAIDS since 1999, working in a number of capacities focused on the analysis of the global AIDS epidemic and effective responses. From 92 until 99, he worked on the HIV prevention research project, Retro CI in Cote d'Ivoire, following work in Liberia, DRC, and India. A physician and epidemiologist, Peter is a graduate of universities in the UK and Belgium, and his doctorate in medical sciences in Belgium. So Peter, we decided to start with you as UNAIDS set the 1990 visionary challenge that coalesced all the partners and gave us confidence that we could win this fight. Obviously, having the product available for the patient is a given if 90-90-90 and the end of AIDS is to be achieved. What have you been hearing that we need to do differently, and what modeling have you done on the speed at which countries could reach those targets?
Thanks a lot for the question. And maybe I should give a little bit of background as to how we came to 1990 and also the impact that results from it, because you mentioned the department that I work in. We both receive from all countries their data, including on progress with treatment and other data. But our department also has been central to the modeling that actually informs that 1990-90. So briefly, this was done back in 2014, and the intention was to see what is needed in the AIDS response, in the global AIDS response, to take us towards ending the AIDS epidemic. And so that was translated itself in a 90% reduction of incidence and mortality. And then, of course, treatment is a very important pillar within that. And the treatment effect, or the effect of treatment on incidence reduction, is very central and makes up close to like half of the full impact on incidence reduction, besides other elements. And so 1990, as David said, maybe it does not need explanation, but it is key to understand that like 1990 is an essential element for that impact to be achieved. Like if we do not reach 1990, we will also not achieve that reduction in incidence. So today there is, like we have also put out a report just a week ago that gives the current status of where we are in the achievement of 1990. And at the end of 2015, we estimate there's about 17 million people on treatment. and it translates in terms of 1990, it translates in awareness that we estimate at about 57% globally. That is to say 57% of all people living with HIV know that they are living with HIV, and treatment coverage of about 46%. And finally, the level of viral suppression currently is estimated at about 38%. So that last pillar, 38%, is only about half of what it needs to be for us to achieve that incidence reduction. Also, if I can just mention, we mentioned 17 million people on treatment. Of those, there are close to 900 children, because children, of course, need their own specificity in terms of formulations and also have implications for supply chain. So maybe the last thing I should say just in this introductory remarks is to say that just being at this conference, there is many studies from either small areas or from entire countries that actually show the achievability of 1990 in the sense that some areas or some studies are saying we have reached, say, the second 90, we have actually demonstrated we have that, or also we have we are very close to achieving all three of the 90s. So it just gives the confidence that it isn't just as it was at the start, like an input to a model that then says, oh, if you do all of this, you will get to the incidence rate, but it gives the confidence that it's actually possible to achieve in the real world, because if it is possible in several places, there is really no reason why it would not be possible elsewhere. Of course, there's a whole load of things behind that, because other places that are currently not doing so well, I'm sure they're lacking in infrastructure, and maybe some of it is also related to supply chain. So maybe that's it for introductory remarks. I'll be happy to come back on specifics.
Thank you, Peter. It's you indicated in terms of achieving the 90-90-90, we're basically at 57, 46, 38, kind of globally. But it can differ quite starkly between country and country, or districts and regions. So it'll be interesting to explore that impact on the supply chain, not just the global numbers, but where it differs. All right, I'd like to turn to Dr. Daniel Lobier with WHO. WHO provides the normative guidance, which is so interlinked with the UNAIDS targets. Dr. Lobier is coordinator of strategic information and country planning at WHO. He is the coordinator for HIV strategic information and planning. This covers global reporting, disease surveillance, drug and diagnostic reporting, and country support. He has worked previously in the Global Program on AIDS and the Global Fund, leading its focus on results, impact, and aid effectiveness at Cambridge University and in South Africa, working with country HIV programs. So Daniel, the call to treat all is the biggest change in the guidelines. A similar question for you: what are you hearing that countries need to do differently? And what are you seeing in the strategic information you see at WHO on the plans, progress, and innovations?
So thank you. Thanks for the question. And it really is the challenge I think we've put out here to support the 1990 targets is treat all. So the next stage we're really saying is that challenge of treat all. I think it is worth just pausing. I mean, I was here in 2000, just pausing on what has been achieved since then. I mean, there were no procurement supply systems in this continent. The drugs were expensive, they were toxic. The health system would have difficulties in, I mean, I actually probably didn't even have the confidence to link many people to the supply chains and to treatment. And where we've come is to the figures that UNAIDS have released, which is, I mean, almost 50% coverage, 46% coverage in this continent. So for me, that has been a huge success, and it gives me confidence that we can rise to that challenge of the next stage, which is moving towards treat all. And it is a big challenge, but I think it's one that is going to require that similar effort, the use of data, and many of the innovations. So that's the challenge we're putting out. It's actually, there's four components behind it. We have new guidelines on treatment, on testing, So some of the innovations in self-testing, on strategic information, because you need a set of indicators along your cascade to support patients over the medium term, no leakages when you have testing, linking people to care, putting them on treatment, the systems to keep them on treatment, to ensure viral suppression, so you get some of the impact that UNAIDS is showing, both on mortality, but also crucially on new infections, because decisively we need to reduce new infections to make this a long-term, sustainable, impactful market for ARVs and diagnostics. And then finally, we have guidelines on key populations, because for us it is very important, the innovations I've been seeing in data and reaching the most difficult populations to bring them into treatment, that's going to be increasingly important as we move towards that full coverage of treat all. So first of all, I mean, I'll go through each other. First of all, the treatment components. I think it does suggest we need, first of all, to double the number of people on treatment and probably go even slightly further because there's still new incidents coming in there. And that means in the next 5 years, there is a huge opportunity for drugs and diagnostics, but it's also, there's a constrained opportunity because there's a number of other innovations that we also suggest we need to achieve in that. We need some shifts in the quality of the regimes and the drugs in the triple therapy at price points which are similar or less to what we have now. And we know that it's when we bring in new patients that we have that ability to improve some of these regimens, to bring in the most effective regimens to ensure long-term stability on patients. So that is the big opportunity. We know 50% of patients are going to be coming in if we reach these targets in the next 5 years, and it's to ensure some of those improvements in the basic drug regimes. Secondly, then, is in the frequency of delivery of drugs, is to really simplify the delivery of treatments. I'll come to the testing component because that's obviously crucial, but it's also in trying to stage the delivery of drugs so we can move towards 3-6 months delivery of drugs where possible. I know PEPFAR often starts with 6 months. Our guidelines are 3 to 6 months, but where possible, we've looked at all the clinical evidence and there's no negative evidence to move that in. But behind that is identifying and differentiating between a stable cohort of patients where you can do this and bringing them onto simplified treatments, and also identifying a group where we need some of the more difficult second regimes where there may be resistance issues so we can deal with some of those components. It's having that component. And then the final recommendation, there's a whole series, but the final key one is around differentiated care, that ensuring we have innovations in the delivery of care, community delivery, and that the drugs are delivered at the right level and as close as we can to the patients, knowing that there is a differentiation clearly between stable patients, which are stable, and a group we need to provide more frequent care. So that management is going to be crucial for this to be sustainable and impactful over the next 5 years. Second big bit is on the testing. I think probably one of the more innovative parts is we're moving from certainly CD4-CD350, 500, to the evidence now is treatment should be offered when there is testing. And that's a big challenge for the diagnostics market. It's to bring testing as close to people, to provide the tests as quickly as you can, and to strengthen that linkage, which we know we lose people at each stage. Each time we touch the cascade, we lose people, and we need to try and improve that. There's certainly recommendations coming through on self-testing, innovation in diagnostics. The second component on diagnostics is still to focus on yields. So it is really to look at the impact we can have on testing, ensure it is well targeted to the groups, that we have that intelligence in the way we deliver, so that we are testing people where we can have a yield to bring them into treatment, because it's a large part of the market, we know. And it's again a one where we need more testing, but we also need more effective testing to bring people into treatment. Strategic information, I think using data, we will talk about. We have strategic information guidelines which really try and support people over the medium time along the cascade. So we really need a few linked indicators which understand, as you mentioned, potentially people who know their status, that we clearly link them to care as soon as we can, that they come onto treatment, and that we work also on retention and viral suppression. So we have a very few indicators, but they're now all organized along this cascade to bring in the innovations. And then just finally is key populations. It's really also leaving nobody behind. It's bringing in the most difficult populations as we get, hopefully, to 60, 70, 80, 90% coverage. It's going to be increasingly, and we've actually been talking on the panel some of the innovative ways they use that data on taxi ranks, on going into the townships in South Africa to ensure that the most difficult populations, because Treat All is about bringing all people on treatment quickly into testing and into treatment and keeping them on treatment so that we can have the impact. So it's a very exciting period. My final remarks, it's a period of opportunity, but with some of those constraints on innovation, on using our resources effectively and ensuring we can bring everybody onto treatment to achieve what is the 90-90-90, which is a long-term sustainable view where we can have a strong market and a strong delivery of diagnostics and treatment, but ones which can also manage the epidemic and bring down mortality, but also new infections, which we need to do in the next 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. Just listening to you and Peter talk about the guidance coming forward, demonstrates the challenges that are going to be in the supply chain, because that is really huge changes and disruptions in the supply chain when you start looking at differentiated care, prescribing at the community level. Some countries are talking about a whole new level of distribution in the supply chain rather than taking levels out, putting a new level in at the lowest point. So it will be very, very challenging. So you said price point on drugs, the same or lower. So that sounds like an introduction for Arvind with Mylan. So Arvind Kanda is Vice President and Head Commercial Business of ARV and Infectious Diseases as Mylan. Arvind is a mechanical engineer with an MBA from the Indian Institute of Management. He has spent 11 of the last 17 professional years in the pharma industry, 3 years in Dr. Reddy's focusing on corporate planning, strategy, and M&A, and over 9 years now at Matrix Mylan. He joined the Global Alliances team and has spent the last 9 years in ARV fixed dose formulation sales and traveling frequently around the world. Arvind ensures that Mylan sustains market leadership in the HIV space, continues to differentiate through innovation and speed on new products, ensuring operational edge through high quality cost and service in the access markets. His education includes the Indian Institute of Management and his MBA from Indore and University College, Osmania College University. Actually, I think I'm seeing a pattern here between the bios for the commercial sector and the nonprofit sector, the public sector here, in terms of length. So Arvind, David seemed to be fairly optimistic that the ARV manufacturers will respond. Is he right? Or perhaps a better question is, what do we need to do differently to innovate and to enable the answer to that question to be yes? He spoke of forecasting and longer predictability for your planning, but is there more to it than that?
So I think to start with, I think as a community, you know, as a collaboration of, you know, profit, non-profit, all of us together, I think we take where we are at this stage today, if we go back to 2000 or 2001, and you know, if we looked at, if anyone gave us a scenario of 17 million patients, first line below $100, you know, $100 per patient per year, much below $100, and second line below $250 per patient per year, I think, you know, as a global community, we take it, and, you know, more than take it. So I think all this has been achieved, and it's not come easily. You know, the capacity has been created, and there was a cost to creating capacity. If you look at all the companies, the manufacturers which contributed to this, I'm sure $500 million have been spent just on creating API capacity to treat these patients. And you know, if the problem with defining the ARV space as a business is, profit might be a bad word in this space, but then investment and profit go together. Investment comes out of profit. And you have to have a sustainable commercial business model to sustain 15 to 30 million patients. It's not going to come out of charity. So that's a very important understanding. It's something which, you know, which people need to recognize, and that's what has delivered even the 16 million. It's not as if, you know, 16 million has come out of charity or corporate social responsibility. It's important you make a commercial sustainable return on your investment in this space. Second thing, if you just look at some of these, some of the data, TLE today, just the tenofovir, lamivudine, efavirenz, it's probably the single largest generic drug in the world across any other drug in terms of volume. And the way it is bought, the way it is delivered, I'm sure there are ways we can improve it. I mean, if it is the single largest generic drug in the world, then we need to treat it, and from also all points of view, as the single largest drug, and have better ways of managing it. Going forward, it might be the 400, it might be TAF, it might be dolutegravir, but if these are going to be four of the single largest combinations in the world, then we've got to find better ways of managing them. I also feel that 1 to 17 million patients is not going to be the same. The 17 to 30 journey is going to be different from 1 to 17. Procurement methods have to change, approaches have to change, things have to get more, frequencies have to change, things have to go more predictable. People can't afford to fail, people can't afford to, take each other for granted. We'll have to work together much more collaboratively in the future than we did in the past. If we have to move from 17 to 30, as we did from 1 to 17. And I think the most important thing is taking the focus away from the price point to the cost point. I think the new formulations will be there. The industry will deliver on TAF. They will deliver on dolutegravir. We will deliver on low dose of efavirenz. And this is the way to go. Cost is what we should talk about rather than the price, because price is a function of, who is willing to go lower. Cost is who is willing to put in the effort to bring the base down. So I think that's the direction in, which I'd like to take this discussion on, the cost rather than the price. And the incremental innovations are there. I mean, the 3 months pack, the 9 months pack, as you get smaller, the 6 months pack, as you get smaller tablets, you can give a 6 month pack. If you get healthier volunteers, you need not see them for 3 months maybe. So these innovations are possible, but then commercial interest has to be sustained. It has to be a commercial sustainable business model, and only then it will work, this 30 million patients we're talking about. I think the last point, I think the patients are also going to get harder to find. If I go to Nigeria, if I go in my country of birth, that's India, I mean, we're talking about the 17 to 30, but how difficult it is to move, the needle from, if you look at the coverage in Nigeria for the past 5 years, we're still talking about a 30% or 40%. So, I mean, finding the patients will be more difficult, and I don't know how, I really don't know the answer to, probably we can get it from our panelists in terms of, what methods we have to find more patients.
Thank you, Arvind. Your comment on the next lift from 17 to 30 million is going to be more difficult than the first lift. I'd like to come back to that later in the conversation. But moving on at this point to Willem. Willem Pretorius is Vice President of Sales in Africa for Alere. He's a physiologist by profession. He specialized in immunology and molecular biology in his postgraduate studies covering apoptosis and signal transduction pathways that control the cellular process. Pursued a career in the medical device industry and gained experience building biotech businesses in Africa and globally. Extensive travel has provided Willem with immense practical experience at the grassroots level of the challenges experienced in healthcare around the world today. Over the last 20 years, Willem has worked in a number of companies, gaining cross-functional experience and taking several products from concept through R&D and scale-up to full commercialization in the global health space. He has successfully worked with government and funders in partnership to bring fundamental change in the way that patients receive healthcare. So Willem, a similar question for you. Diagnostics are essential to both the first and the third 90. Arvind addressed the middle 90. David was fairly confident that your industry had planned the necessary production capacity. Is that right? And if so, what do we need to innovate elsewhere in the supply chain to improve the availability? There's been a lot of technical innovation for the third 90, but screening has hardly changed over the last period of time. What's on the horizon?
Well, thank you very much, Gordon. If I think about what happened with HIV over the last number of years, I think a common theme, and I think it's been sort of reiterated in this conference, is the power of collaboration and the power of partnership. You know, the power of partnership between industry, government, implementers, funders, and academics. And I can assure you that industry is right up there as a partner. We've worked really well with everybody over the last number of years to be able to provide the commodities, to be able to get where we are today. But what's ahead of us is a huge challenge. And we do have to work together and we have to innovate together. When we look at 1990 from our perspective, by both being a resident of Africa and travel, I'm probably one of the only executives that really still want to go to the cold face, to the rural areas in Africa, and really see what happens there, because that's where I believe your strategy has to come from as a global company. And you know, when I look at Africa today, we still live in an Africa where 60% of our population lives in rural Africa. And if we look at where we are at the moment with 1990, I think if you cascade that down and look at where are we with 1990 in rural Africa compared to where we are with 1990 in urban Africa, I think the situation is much worse. So we need to be able to bring diagnostics and healthcare to rural Africa. And I believe the only way that we can do this to reach scale is to really go down the healthcare pyramid to primary healthcare. So this is an area where we have invested in innovation a lot. You asked the first question on screening. So yes, it's true, there's been little innovation in screening over the last number of years, but lately we have now a fourth generation rapid diagnostic that is very, very close to the performance of your fourth generation laboratory tests that could be rolled out. And I think especially when it comes to test and treat and really increasing case finding, you know, to get to that first 90, I think it will play a very important role. We also have now diagnostics where an HIV test could be combined with some other disease states. You know, and a good example of that is by screening for both syphilis and HIV simultaneously in one test. But as we heard from some of the other panelists, data is very, very important for us to be able to get to 1990. So one of the things that we have to overcome if we want to go down to primary healthcare is we need to get real-time data on things like consumption of commodities. So a lot of innovation have come through the power of the mobile phone. So today we can have point-of-care diagnostics that can be connected via a modem, and data on consumption can be collected in real time and transmitted to central planning warehouses. And then you can obviously put the inventory on site in there. As you do the tests, it basically takes real-time data on how you use the tests. And then you can predict stockout dates and you can predict resupply dates. And you can also look at your entire country or your entire region and really prioritize areas where you need to supply first. So this is a sort of innovation where I think industry and government and implementers can really work actually much better. In the future, we will have rapid screening readers that will work off a mobile phone so that we can also start to track, you know, rapid tests and the use of rapid tests. And then when we move to that last 90, when we look at viral load monitoring and making sure that all our patients that is on treatment is virologically suppressed, we see now that viral load point of care testing is becoming a reality. We have devices now for early infant diagnosis that have actually come through the WHO pre-qualification process that is available for procurement. And these devices, by the way, have also been linked up with these connectivity networks. So for the epidemiologists, you would be able to see what is the community viral load in a specific region, and is interventions bringing down community viral load. So we'll be able to track much better, you know, whether the strategies that we employ is working effectively, and we will have data available, you know, in almost near real time. I think this will inform the strategies moving forward, you know, when we look at tackling the disease and making an end to AIDS by 2030.
Thank you, Willem. This discussion started at the policy level, has moved through the global level, and now you brought it down to the site level in country. And Iain Barton is our next speaker, and his company works at that in-country supply chain level. I think in Nigeria alone, they're distributing products out to 6,000 sites across Nigeria. But Iain is the Group Business Development Executive of Healthcare with Imperial. Iain Barton is a leading expert in developing and implementing best practice supply chain functions in the global health context. Committed South African, he is a medical doctor with 10 years of clinical experience, clinical practice, and 18 years of experience in supply chain management. Iain specializes in pharmaceutical distribution and information technology specific to the pharmaceutical procurement and logistics, and also focuses on market shaping new business startups and international supply chain solutions. Iain is Group Business Development Executive, Healthcare for Imperial, providing strategy and solution coordination across all of Imperial's healthcare businesses. Iain is also the Managing Director of Imperial Health Sciences, which provides complete supply chain management services across Africa for 32 pharmaceutical suppliers, National Departments of Health, the Global Fund, PEPFAR's SCMS, and USAID's newly launched Procurement and Supply Management Project. Dr. Barton was responsible for developing the concept of regional distribution centers to support scale-up of PEPFAR in the early years, which provides life-saving drugs and commodities for more than 6 million HIV/AIDS patients in 17 countries across Africa. Innovations developed under Iain's leadership include the Anjani Clinics, Warehouse in a Box, Clinic in a Box, and U-Pharma. Iain currently serves on the advisory boards of Merck for Mothers, South Africa's Public Health Enhancement Fund, and People That Deliver. There's been a projection made that as we scale up to the next 17 to 30 that Arvind was talking about, that could mean 28 to 35 containers of ARVs alone arriving every day in Africa. And the challenges that that puts on the existing strain supply chain. So Iain, we are still hearing a lot about stockouts. And at this conference, there is a lot of talk about differentiated models of care. When someone comes in to be tested, are they already ill or are they still well? A treatment, are they stable or are they failing? And the cascades of service delivery. How will all of this affect the in-country supply chain, and what innovation is necessary to get to 90-90-90?
Thanks, Gordon. Before I start, can I say, thanks very much for choosing a venue like this. It is so nice to be outside where you can see the sky and some green versus having been stuck in that conference center for the last 3 days. The conference has actually been really interesting. I enjoy these kind of environments because you get to leverage the intellect of the collective. You actually, if you leave a conference of this stature with the same thinking and the same ideas that you arrived with, then you haven't used it to its full potential. And so I've been scribbling furiously as we've been listening to the speakers, and I can tell you that the things I'm going to say are not what I prepared last week, because there's been a lot that I've been listening to over the last 3 days that really have changed the way I'm thinking at the moment about what we need to do. The one thing that's absolutely clear is that what got us here will not get us there. We're going to have to do things differently. We're going to have to do things with a lot more innovation. And innovation is a great concept, it's a great idea, but it comes with a whole impact for those of us who are the investors in these things, because if the methodologies change quickly, that means that your investment becomes defunct, and so your cost versus price issue is a very, very interesting one as we see technologies, especially around test and treat and treatment site level testing. You're going to see very short life cycles in some of the products and the services that are being exhibited in those tents down the back there. So my own thoughts on where this thing's at. You know, the 1990 concept, I'm a great supporter of, and I think it really has changed the way that everybody's thinking. It does presume the fourth 90, though, and that is the prevention aspect. And I don't know that the 90% of people who are positive knowing their status actually gets us as far down the road as we're going to need to go in terms of prevention. But the recurring themes that I've heard over the last few days are really the ones that have started to scare me a lot, because I think we've done the easy bit. I think getting to 17 might actually have been the easy bit, and getting to 30 are going to be the hard yards. Because when you start talking about key affected populations, and you start talking about what effectively are hard to find patients and hard to manage population groups, and you listen to somebody like Mark, who is incredibly well informed, talk at that South Africa event last night and saying that South Africa does not have a single epidemic. South Africa has a myriad of microepidemics, and each of them will require a different method of response and a different way of management. You start to realize that what we're going to have to do as supply chain practitioners is some serious segmentation of our strategies and some seriously sophisticated models of management of those different communities. And we're going to have to really start thinking about what's become known in the private sector as patient-centric supply chain systems. You know, we're going to have to take a lot of the learnings that we're using in the private and commercial business and bring it into this public health space a lot more than we have. You know, the containers discussion is a really interesting one as well, because that's the bit we've always thought of, because it's the way that we were able to express the impact to the policymakers and the funders, is that there's this visual impact of the 35 containers a day. But there's then the next step, which is, so does that mean your number of warehouses has to grow linearly? Because if it does, we don't have enough warehouse space at the moment for the way we're doing it. So that means we've got to double the number of warehouses as well. But nobody's going to have enough money to do that, and nobody's going to have enough people to maintain that. So the only way we're going to get that out of the picture is if we change the way we do downstream supply. We've got to increase the velocity through the supply chain. We're going to have to radically change the way in which we do the downstream delivery, because only if we increase the frequency of delivery downstream can we increase the velocity through the warehouses and thereby reduce the number of warehouses we need to build. So it's going to need us to move our focus away from just the containers on the water, not even just into the warehouses and the sheds, but into the way in which we drive delivery and the way in which we force care and treatment sites to integrate with the supply chain and give us the information we need to do that effectively and fast. So it's going to be about that inverse proportional relationship that exists between scale of warehousing capacity versus frequency of delivery. It's good, simple supply chain practice. It's not rocket science, but it is a whole lot of behavior change and a whole lot of downstream education that we're going to have to do. And just in terms of the way that I think we'll get there, I think one of the most important pieces is that it's going to take an immense amount of collaboration. And one of my things of the moment is we need to stop. In public health, we spend an awful lot of time debating the 15% on the fringe of stuff that we don't agree on, instead of actually concentrating on the 85% of stuff that we do agree on. And yes, good academic debate is a powerful thing, but it needs to happen in that environment. Once we get out into practical application, let's focus on the 85% we do agree on and get it done. So the collaboration is going to be vitally important. And then the last point is that we're going to have to look at the way in which we do this operationally. Governments and donors are going to have to change the way in which they spend the money. Stop spending money building warehouses and buying trucks, and start spending money with people who own trucks, and start spending money with people who own warehouses and are willing to invest in warehouses and trucks. And that means engaging effectively with the private sector. And to do that, we're going to have to drive the psychology of VAN, or Visibility Analytics Network, of the changing the policy, changing the philosophy. That's the fourth P, I think, that should have been in the VAN blueprint. It should have been changing the philosophy of people, changing the policy that allows confident and robust integration of the way in which the public sector then gets involved with the private sector, so that we can build the capacity of people, point the people at the right areas with the right skills, and then put in place those changes in behavior, those changes in process that will get us to deliver the product. But then comes the S of VAN, and that's systems. And there's that famous Bill Gates thing of electrification amplifies. If we haven't fixed the processes and we stick in IT systems, we will make bad processes worse. But if we've actually perfected the others and we then stick in great systems, we'll be able to do things well. And just, Gavin, this idea about integrating testing data with SVS, with the stock visibility data, to be able to better inform supply plans, I think it's a great concept. But if we don't get to that level of sophistication quickly, we're never going to be able to inform the kind of scale that we need to achieve.
Thank you, Iain. So right now we're at the in-country level, service delivery, the 90-90-90 challenge, the new WHO guidelines, the differentiated care, cascades of service are really could potentially transform what happens at the ground level. And I'm curious, Peter or Daniel, are you hearing any feedback from countries that they understand those challenges, the supply chain challenges, and actually getting the products to those patients in this new model?
Right. I think, countries do. And like one of the things that we hear about is about duplicate chains, where like different funders like have their preferred change, and there seems to be just opportunity to rationalize that, and so that it becomes more efficient, because we're focused on HIV obviously, but we should also be thinking that a lot of those patients, they have other needs. And so looking into the future, like the patient that is getting antiretroviral treatment will also be receiving other treatments for other ailments. And that, you know, it can come into the thinking of how the supply chain like need to change. So one other thing I wanted to quickly mention is on the data side, because we mentioned concepts like yields, and a colleague also spoke about like more data that are like very close to the consumption of diagnostics, for example. I think there is, in addition to that, that there is like other data that can also be useful. And in the end, if it can all come together, it will be so much more powerful. So the specific data I'm thinking about is that there has been recently quite a bit of work to try and bring together all of the epidemiological data in models that not just provide information at the country level or province level, but they are starting to inform how many people are living in very small areas. There is actually a session in the conference tomorrow at 11 o'clock about geospatial modeling that actually speaks to that. And so that is another element that combined with data on yield and combined with data on consumption, it can be quite powerful. And just one other thought about additional data is, as we speak about a movement towards communities being more empowered to like be involved in testing efforts, that those same communities can also be involved in reporting of issues with certain clinics. And again, it can just be an additional piece of data that helps us in better managing supplies.
Thank you, Peter. But would like to see if there are any questions, if we can take some questions from the audience. Michelle, do you have a microphone? Any questions in the far back? David?
So, Gordon, thank you for getting together this distinguished panel of leaders in the supply chain management that we're all depending on to get us to triple 90 and beyond. If you'd be so kind, maybe we could do a round amongst each one of them. three points why stockouts are still going on. What are the three leading considerations from each one of the panelists why at this point we still have stockouts going on, and maybe one point each or two or whatever you want to give us about what we can do to stop it? Do we need a new company that specifically specializes in ending stockouts, or is there additional funding that needs to come in a different mechanism that'll end stockouts? How do we end this aberration? Thank you.
Thank you, David, for being kind with us with the question. Arvind, do you want to start, and then we'll just go through the panel?
If you ask me, he asked for 3 points, and I'll say it is, I'll start with indiscipline, whether it's, you know, in terms of forecasting, in terms of ordering, in terms of understanding, you know, information is available if you ask for it. Yeah. Understanding which product, how much volumes, which product is difficult to make, the information is there. I think as supply chain management, you have it. Global Fund has it, someone else has it. But didenosin today is not as easy to get as a TLE. So, you know, I think it's a lot of education, indiscipline in terms of, and the third part, I think, is a number of regimens, the number of regimens that exist. Even one bottle of didenosin not being available, let's say, in the northernmost part of Africa, creates a stockout, and stockout is not a big stockout. Every stockout is a stockout. So it's not like you're not putting volumes and reams of product into, you know, where into one country. If you're not putting one bottle where it's not required, then it's a stockout. So I think it's absence of, you know, presence of too many regimens, lack of understanding, common understanding of, you know, which product is difficult to manufacture, which product is difficult, you know, is easy, what are the lead times, the information is there. And the third point is pure indiscipline, I think, with across the chain in terms of, you know, ordering patterns, in terms of putting things where it's required.
Right. My thought about this is, again, that like data can help with it, in the sense that like many countries in the region are building district health information systems that carries information from facilities about patients and diagnosis to the center. But those same systems, and like UNAIDS has piloted and or has presented at this conference situation room for Kenya, that same information system, it can also have information about drugs that are being shipped to facilities, and it can carry the feedback information too. And in addition to that, the point I made earlier that like communities can also be empowered and use, like give them power to report stockouts and put like pressure on whoever is responsible for the clinic or for the supply chain management, so that one answer in response to the question has to be like accountability, that yes, we should, like maybe today we have certain number of stockouts, but a year from now we should not allow that same thing to happen. There has to be, somebody has to be responsible for it.
Daniel?
So, I mean, I think it's many of the things you've got here. For me, it's a management issue, and it's the tied up partnership management across the system, so it's coordinating in dealing with those problems. And probably just two bits. One is the decisions are made at the right level, so we do need to make some of those decisions closer to the clinic, closer to the community, so they can be made more rapidly, yeah? So we can get that responsiveness. And, you know, I'm impressed by listening even to some of the panel, the way they're working with difficult clinics, empowering them to make some decisions, empowering some of the nurses. And then the second one is coordinating some of the real-time data so that we get that feedback that goes beyond probably an individual company, where you can see quite quickly that responsiveness from a clinic in relatively quick time. We now have the capabilities and deep into Africa the technologies to do that. So I think you've got many of the solutions. It's a management, but there is that getting the decisions. They clearly fit into our new guidance on differentiated care, on bringing things closer to where the decisions are made, and that backup on strategic information guidance, which is that we have basic data that works across the cascade, so we can see where the leakages are, and is available to everybody where we can, quite transparently, so we can get that response.
Very good. Ian?
Great question, and I'm just, this is going to be a slide for me in every presentation that I do, I think. The first one for me, remote procurement. The idea that we think we can run a supply chain from Bangalore to Lusikisiki and get it right and get it there on time, it beggars belief. And there's a need to move to where we're able to get from manufacturer to point of care quickly and effectively. And one of the reasons that the DDV model has worked so effectively in South Africa is because from the manufacturer inventory until it's in the point of care is 48 to 72 hours. It's not the same if you look at the global procurement structures that are in place. The second one is parallel systems. I don't know why the governments believe that they should run parallel systems. People refer to the private sector as the parallel system. The private sector is the real world. This idea of governments having their own exclusive system, for me, is the definition of a parallel system. And the third is there's the poor data systems, the inability to get access to information quickly and effectively in order to inform movement.
Yep. Willem?
Now, from me, I'm a real practical guy. So if you go out to these sites, the one that sort of comes immediately to mind was actually Uganda. The problem is when you start to have services really at that low level, and it's actually a very good thing, is people talk. And so what happens is you plan for certain volumes, and as people talk, more patients come. And when we collect data, I think our data is always a little bit behind. So it doesn't keep track with that increasing demand, and that's where we run into trouble. So by having real-time data, you know, you overcome that problem. And in Uganda, they've implemented this in the CD4 program by using the mobile networks and getting more real-time data. And stockouts was down by about 90%, and service delivery went up about four times, you know, in terms of delivery. So I think that ability to have real-time data really helps. And then, you know, from us as a manufacturer, one thing that you want to do as a manufacturer is you want to plan for the eventuality, right? So you want to have actually linear manufacturing because that is more cost effective. That's how we get the price down for you, is by not running manufacturing and peaks and troughs because that drives cost. But you want to be able to manufacture linearly, and then you will be able to stockpile products so that you can respond to increases, spikes of demand. And I think we need to maybe look at our the criteria that we set for procurement. You know, I think one thing that have been a problem for industry for a long time is the requirement of delivering 80% of maximum shelf life. Because if you do this, actually you penalize the manufacturer who increase its shelf life. Because you're setting a higher benchmark for that company to somebody who keeps their shelf life short. And if you do that, you make it almost impossible for the company to be able to build up a good inventory so that they can rapidly respond to rapid increases in demand. So I think it makes much more sense to set a minimum amount of months that is workable in country, you know, for the logistics system to be able to provide patients access to drugs that would be within the expiry date, would not lead to maximum sort of lots of write-offs of stock that would not be used, but then still give the industry partners the ability to have that capacity to rapidly then respond to increases in demand that wasn't planned for.
Thanks, Willem. I know David wasn't asking that question of me, just the panelists. But But it's really about management, execution, and transparency in the systems. I don't think there's been a time, Arvind, when we've gone out to buy ARVs on the global level and we couldn't buy them. They're there. The manufacturers know the planning and the forecasts, and they've stayed ahead of the game in their investments, except for pediatric ARVs, which is a special case in terms of the global organizations working together to meet that need. But there's always been product available. At the regional level, there's product available. Even in central medical stores, in the government, the product is there, but it's not getting out to the sites. And I think that's the management and execution to get from that point to the actual sites. And that's just going to get more complicated with these new models that we're all discussing. There are some examples where we have done it well. In Nigeria, we're delivering to about 6,000 sites every 2 months, 95% on time, all proof of deliveries received. Rwanda has put in a system called One Network that goes all the way down to the site level and tracks in a mix of both manual and electronic, the product levels there, and automatically generates the orders that are placed. So there are examples like that where in the private sector or the government, adopting private sector approaches has proven successful. And at the end of the day, it's all about KPIs, key performance indicators that you manage that distribution channel through. So do we have any more questions?
Yes, thank you. I'm Tina from MSF. Thank you for all the discussions and all the different points of view. I just want to mention that MSF and other organizations that have been in the sessions at the conference there's a lot of experience with this implementation of these differentiated care models in different countries. We see it as absolutely necessary, and we think that eventually we should be arriving at a point where a patient chooses what he wants, so we can provide them with any different option, which could be either multiple months refills, could be a club or a community art group, or we should leave the choice to the patients in order to be able to keep them on their regimens, to keep them retaining care. Some of the things we see that are necessary in order to reduce stockouts, and we've actually written a report on it, and I have a few with me in case you want to read it. So one of the things that's missing is common definitions. So depending on who you talk to, a stockout is either a missing drug at a central level or at a depot, while for us, stockouts are only valid if it means that a patient goes without drugs. The WHO at the WHA has come up with a resolution in order to develop these definitions, but so far they haven't been finalized yet, I think. Maybe Mr. from WHO can comment on that. Then KPIs, very relevant, but what are the KPIs we're gonna use to monitor a supply chain system? What are the systems that work? Are we gonna look at whether your medicines are actually delivered, or do we wanna know how many patients actually got the right treatment? And maybe how many patients that are stable have access to 3 and 6 month supply? So we need indicators that evaluate your system and that can give evidence on what kind of system works in which kind of setting and what are critical enablers to make that work. What's missing to discuss this is a forum. There's a lot of forums where people come together and discuss global procurement plans, but as far as we know, there's no common forum where everyone gets together and discusses technicalities of in-country supply chains, what's necessary, what works in which context, and how are we going to measure that. There's very little scientific data on supply chain systems. And then the last point I want to make, and it's already been raised as well, is any service can only work if there's an external quality control. And we see indeed a critical role for communities as end users of the service, patients that can be reporting whether your service is functioning or not. And there's a brilliant example of that in South Africa. It's called the Stop Stockouts Project. We have some data on that. It's a citizen-based reporting of stockouts, and it's all focusing on transparency, accountability, and providing the visibility or the end-level data that are often missing. So another question is, how are we going to engage with these communities to make sure they can assist, to influence, and to improve supply chain and eventually stop stockouts? Thank you.
All right, thank you very much for that question. We'll take one more question and then we'll finish up.
Mine is maybe more of a reflection of what was said. You've done the easy bit. So your public health approach to the value chain, and you'll notice I use the value chain, has got you where you are. But in the South African context, what we realize is when we got to 1.5 million, the systems that we needed to go to 3.4 million were very, very different. And I am thinking I have another learning curve to get to the 7 million mark. And that's looking at a national level. And as Tina was sort of pointing out, we have to look at this as a value chain as opposed to a supply chain. And it's good that on the panel you had the manufacturers. What we are doing at the moment in South Africa, I want to know what the manufacturer's API stock is. I want to know what their production plans are. And that gets put into my visual analytics network. And then I go down to what the primary healthcare facility is doing. And again, stop stockouts, people will tell you. When you do that, it's scary because you're looking under the hood of a broken motor car, because we have what I call a public health MPH type supply chain, which is irrelevant for this type of scale. And we see this playing out in our system time and time again. Paracetamol is another big, fast-moving line item in this country. When things go wrong, they go wrong massively. The ACE inhibitors, such as enalapril, when things go wrong, they go wrong massively. Something like carbimazole, I can quickly sort that out with a few telephone calls, shifting something from here to there. So when you're planning this, think very carefully about the fact that there's a big difference to going to full scale, and the doubling is not about just taking what you've done to get to you where you are. There's a big learning curve for all of us ahead. And I agree 100% wholeheartedly with a colleague from the diagnostics site. We should be looking at how do we leapfrog what technology offers us in Africa using cell phone technology, and that is the way forward rather than clipboards and bin cards.
Thank you, Gavin. South Africa has been leading the way moving through this these different models of service. And Arvind, I think you had raised the question, moving the first 1 to 17 was easier than maybe the 17 to 30. So why don't we finish up with final thoughts? And Arvind, let's start with you.
I think it's been a great discussion. I think I've learned things which, you know, it's looking at things from a different perspective. I mean, the perspective that, you know, Peter brings to the table, I mean, you know, it's not something which we are used to looking at, you know, from our side. But I think final thoughts, I mean, from a manufacturer's point of view, the commitment to the newer formulations, the TAFs, the dolutegravirs, the 400s, efavirenz 400, darunavir, they will be there at costs which are lower than the existing formulations are available today. It's there. Now the point is, how well do you want to utilize this commitment to take this population from 17 to 30 million with better drugs, with smoother supply chains, with better methods of buying, with more predictable methods of ordering, and, you know, actually making it easier for us to deliver, since we will deliver on the newer formulations. So how well do you want to use this, you know, pledge of delivery to make it easier, you know, to give drugs to the 30 million patients? I think that's the main part from our side.
Thanks, Arvind. Peter?
Right. For me, too, it's been in part a learning discussion for myself. So I would just make maybe one response to the comments that came from MSF to say that in the political declaration, which was like adopted a month ago by all countries about HIV and AIDS, that within that there is the commitment like to reach 90-90-90, but there is also a specific commitment to like community involvement in the provision of services, and therefore it is an instrument that can also be used, and to the extent that countries have signed up to this declaration, it is something that they have also committed to, so that I think it can be used as you know, as this movement takes place to give some more or a bigger role for communities also in the delivery of services.
Daniel? So,
first, just briefly to the MSF, which is a very good question. We are working. We need the stockouts measure that it gets closer to the interruption of care to the patient. And one is a definition, and the two is actually integrating further the drug and diagnostic, the logistics management information systems with the patient information systems, so we can have some of the epidemic data and some of the patient data, and ensuring the drug and diagnostics are there, and if possible, linking it to interruption in treatment. And some of the stockouts relate to that, and she's right, some of them are at a high level, so that is one of the things we are working on. In response to this comment, I don't think we did the easy part. When I look back at 2000, for me, it is incredibly difficult to create a market. When I look through the policy changes, even in South Africa, to get access, the development in the treatments from what they were in 2000. It's been an incredible partnership and collaboration, and I think the people here have contributed hugely. And the coverage of treatments, and many of our report last year was on how it's being led by innovations in Africa. I mean, quite distinctively in health, the coverage of ARV treatments in Africa is actually now slightly higher than in many of the other major regions. Distinctively, you're slightly more likely to get HIV treatment if you're positive in some of these most isolated villages than you are in some other regions. And that's quite distinctive in development, so we've come a long way. But it is a big shift for the next 5 years, and it's a transition from that emergency response to what you're creating is a sustainable, with a good amount of innovation, a sustainable, impactful value market, one which can change HIV and provide a basis for sustaining treatment for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. And that is an incredibly important challenge, which I think this group has got, but one, you have many of the key components to do that. It would look impossible, but if I put myself back in 2000 and look where we are in 2015, I think we can do that. And also when we're working with African countries, there are a lot of countries now building in the 1990 targets in the next 2 or 3 years. They're not behind that. Then in some ways, they're leading many other regions of the world. So it's got all those challenges, and it's about moving towards a public health value chain, as well as delivering commodities, looking at the gaps, the innovations, the changes of the partnership to do that. But I think it's one that the partners here can rise to.
A man with a hand and the mic.
Go ahead, David.
Thanks, Gordon. This question may give you a little bit of tacticardia, given that it's coming from me. But I'd just like to ask the panelists, as someone who's involved with AIDS treatment activism for more than my share of time, what messages, what type of effort, what kind of advocacy needs to be done with the policy leaders, with the folks at the GOP Doctors Caucus, and I single that out, at an international AIDS conference, because the U.S. is carrying the very vast bulk of the donations right now, while we wait for China to step in. So, sorry, was that inappropriate? With that said, what do the manufacturers need? What do you guys need to have coming down from the policy leaders so that you can get more efficient, so you can do your jobs better?
So we'll continue on in the final statements, but David, you know, feel free to come up and talk directly to the panelists here as well. They'll have a few minutes. But to your point to the manufacturers or to industry, maybe Iain, you could finish up, and Willem as well, and address that point.
Yeah, and just before I go there, anybody who hasn't read the MSF report, I hope you've got plenty copies there, because I would commend you get a copy and read it. The case studies in there are superb in terms of just informing you of the different ways in which things are being done and what is working. There's some great recommendations in it. But also, it does represent a really nice spectrum of the different ways that countries have to accommodate their own level of maturity, both of their private sector and of their response to the epidemic. I would also say that around the standards thing, I think I couldn't agree with you more. I think there's a couple of places we could do that. We could be able to go to the policymakers with recommendations. We could either do it through the International Association of Public Health Logisticians, or we could do it through people that deliver, or we could do it through APICS or the Supply Chain Council. So there's various organizations. My preference would be APICS because it would give you the commercial input as well as the public health input. But with there's definitely an opportunity to create a forum that we could provide recommendations back. But then it's about making sure that we collaborate to put together decent guidelines, good standards, and standards that not only achieve what we think is necessary, but absolutely align the incentives for the patient population and for the people within the policy making places so that we get everybody's buy-in to what we're actually trying to do. If you ask me what I need from a policy point of view, David, get the governments to spend their money as a customer and not as an investor.
Willem?
Yeah, I think I liked very much what Iain said about, you know, the 85 and 15%. I think we've all got much more in common than where we differ. And you know, thinking about just the common old thing about price, right, and sustainability. I think all of us have to balance the books, whether you work in industry, whether you run an NGO, whether you run a government. At the end of the day, you need to balance the books. But I think also on the flip side, I think there's much more openness today in today's world to think differently, completely differently in how we work together. I mean, if we just think over the last number of years, Apple took a weakness in content and they opened up the Apple Store and allowed people to write content for them. And they've got 100 billion downloads of that App Store today. And that's probably their competitive advantage today. Look at how Uber changed the taxi industry globally. This is the way that I think, even in industry, we are thinking today. And if we think about these tools that we develop that work through mobile networks, I think we are very open to open up APIs so that consumption data from a device can send data and link up with an epidemiology database or a geographical information system and provide collective data that helps us all focus our attention and our strategy on where our efforts are going to pay off the most dividends. And, you know, so what do we need, I think, you know, from government? I think it's that openness to engage across the spectrum and really share and be open and to be also willing to think differently and not to think that we have to do things like we've done it for the last 50 years.
Well, I want to thank all the panelists for your insights into the challenges and innovations required to meet the 90-90 targets. Let's give them all a hand of applause. And I want to thank you all for coming, and we went on a little bit longer, but that's because the panelists enjoyed the view behind you, so we went on a little bit longer. But thank you very much for coming. Have a good day.